Hello. In today's episode, we're going to talk about International Harvester in 1979, one of the greatest years in history for that company, followed by one of the worst.
And we're in 1979. So 1979 is about as fascinating a year as you can get in IH. So this headline's from December 21. So in 79, Harvester sales exceeded $3 billion. They had the highest profit ratio in the history of the company, $370 million in profit. Something we haven't really touched on is profitability was a big problem for this company. We talked about that a little bit, and it's a well-known thing that they just were, you know, they were running 4 to 6% and the competition was running 8 to 10. And in 79, they had a 9.55% profitability. Now, there was some asterisk marks on that. And I'm curious on your feedback on this. Apparently, UK tax credits, UK changed their tax law, and that added $49 million. So that happened. But also, a lot of people in the newspapers at the time were saying, look, the dealers knew this strike was coming. They stocked up. And that loaded this dollar amount. Do you guys remember that? Does that strike you as a possibility from that era?
I don't remember that.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I don't. You know, at the time, the expectation was the ag market was going to remain strong for a long time.
Yeah.
So, you know, I always looked at it, until you could stand and look backwards, I always looked at it as good business.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's gearing up for the good times.
Yeah.
And of course, the strike came along, and then, you know, then the ag business slid downhill, and we all know the results.
Yeah. Yeah. And 79 was unbelievable with those sales. 79 also, if you did all the math, so Archie McCardell's deal, I'll go briefly into this. This is in the book if you really want to read about it. Archie McCardell's deal that he would get to keep his loan if IH's profit margin exceeded the average profit margin of the competitors. Their profit margin that year was 9.55. The others, it was like 9.3. Massey Harris recorded a zero. If Massey hadn't been at zero, they wouldn't have made it. But Massey basically blew up that year, had a horrible year, and skewed it. So his loan was forgiven, and that was that happens a little later. Big PR problem. People are not happy because of what happens. So I think we've touched on the strike. The strike begins November 1, 1979. One thing I would love to hear from you guys, and obviously this is a huge strike, 35,000 UAW workers go on strike. Archie definitely, from the history side, Archie decided, from my understanding, is he and one of his guys did a lot of the negotiation. He needed to get something out of the union, but he was awfully hard on him and played a role in this, is how I understand it. How did this hit the company? This must have been a tough time for you guys when this news hits. Or wasn't it that big of a deal? I don't know.
Well, my perspective was we were bleeding anyway before this. It was a series of bad news that was hitting. So we were sort of conditioned, like, you know, we've survived this long. Maybe we can get through this too. But what I do remember about that year, the strike was announced. I was at a meeting downtown, and Gerry, you might have been there. All the regions were in. And they were announcing the 1980 business year, and it was in November of 1979. And Stan Lancaster announced that the strike had occurred, and he told us all to do as everything you can to sell products out of Hamilton and Saltillo, Mexico, because you're not going to get anything from any of the U.S. plants. And I thought that was fairly profound. But, you know, the other thing they did that you guys might remember, they asked us to take all of your 1980 vacation now, because when this comes back, we got to work like dogs to pull this thing out of the ditch. You guys remember taking vacation in 79?
Yep.
Yeah. It was we and we did. I mean, we took everything we could from 80. They moved it ahead because you're not going to take any vacation in 1980.
Yeah, that going that meeting was, in retrospect, it was kind of a cheerleading meeting, to be honest, and it was supposed to build confidence, but no one in that room had any idea this thing was going to last for a year, not even close. I
Right.
mean, a couple of months, and you need to, suck it up a little bit, watch your expenses, do the vacation thing, but nobody had any idea. So whatever that, Lee, when you mentioned the inventory leading up to that year, that was small potatoes compared to the inventory that was gushed out of the company after that strike was over in a market that was just sad, just really sad. So
Yeah.
that.
So when it wraps, the production was ramped up over. So this is the day. This is a photo for that we found that is the Melrose plant. April the strike closes. I think it was April 20th. This is the first shift to be done. These guys are leaving, and obviously, guys are happy to get back to work. So at that point, they overbuilt. Is what you're saying, Jerry? That then you get loaded
I
up.
mean, given what the market was, absolutely.
Of course, January 79, before this, what we have happen is the grain embargo. Grain embargo, interestingly, if you look back in the history, the grain embargo actually wasn't what tanked the whole thing. It hurt. But the market does tank, and we go into the most difficult time in modern times on the farm. At this point, the dominoes are starting to fall. Cub Cadet is sold in February 1 of 1981, and in May, the solar division is sold.
So these were really hard times for International Harvester and for the country. The farm crisis, in 1881, the farm crisis was just getting rolling. The interest rates were high, it was difficult, but honestly, things on the farm would worsen over the next few years. At Harvester, there was this very interesting meeting of things. So this company, remember in 77, brought in McCardell. And they just poured all this energy and money and effort into building these fantastic new things. And despite the fact when 1980 closed, they had lost almost $400 million. 1980 was a disaster. Despite that, the company was charging ahead because they had a lot of new products. And honestly, from a historian's point of view, they were doing what needed to be done. So for the company, as they came through this tough year of 1980 and into 81, things were looking exciting and promising. And that brings us to our next episode, and we're going to talk about the launch of the 50 series, which happens in fall of 81. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll catch you again at the next episode.